विल क्विकली रिकैप चैप्टर 3 दैट इज टैक्स रेट्स विच आर एप्लीकेबल फॉर डिफरेंट कैटेगरी ऑफ असेसेस फॉर फाइनेंशियल ईयर 2021 और असेसमेंट ईयर 2021-22. सो द टैक्स रेट्स वॉट एवर इज एप्लीकेबल इज गिवन इन द एनुअल फिनेंस एक्ट. देर आर एक्चुअली टू टाइप्स ऑफ टैक्स रेट्स. वन इज नॉर्मल रेट, द अदर वन इज स्पेशल रेट्स. स्पेशल रेट्स विल ऑलवेज बी गिवन इन द एक्ट, लाइक 111A, 112A, 115BB, ऑल दोज थिंग्स वुड बी गिवन इन द इनकम टैक्स एक्ट 1961, वेर एज अवर नॉर्मल रेट्स विल ऑलवेज बी स्पेसिफाइड इन एनुअल फिनेंस एक्ट. सो द टैक्स रेट्स अप्लीकेबल फॉर द असेसी डिपेंड्स ऑन वॉट इज द कैटेगरी ऑफ ए पर्सन, वेदर इज एन इंडिविजुअल, एचयू ऑफ कंपनी, पार्टनरशिप फॉर्म लाइक दैट, एंड वॉट इज द इनकम ऑफ एन इंडिविजुअल, बिकॉज हायर द इनकम हायर विल बी द टैक्स लाइबिलिटी. Then coming to the residency status of a person, whether the individual or the assessee is a resident or ordinary or not ordinary or non-resident as well. Because for residents, some tax benefits has been given under Income Tax Act. Then age of the individuals, especially an individual who is a resident in India who is 60 or more or 80 or more will be getting some basic exemption limit, extended limit. Fine. Chalo. Next, type of income. As I told you, there are two category of income. Whenever I have an income, check whether my total income includes special income. Sir, what are those special income? We will see later. For special income, always special rates are applicable. First, calculate the tax liability on that special income. Then, calculate the tax on your normal income at whatever rates applicable for you. So, normal rate will be neither flat rate or slab rate for you. Agree? Chalo, we will see first what are the normal rates applicable. We also call it as income tax rate, normal rate or gross rate. So first category of person, any individual, whether he is a resident or non-resident, whether he is a male or female, anything, and every HUF, EOP, BOA or artificial judicial person, we call all this category of person as slab rate assessee. What is the tax rate applicable for them? That is slab rate we call it as. That is, if they have income up to 2,50,000, that is called basic exemption limit, they need not pay any tax. If it is between 2,50,000 to 5,00,000, tax rate is 5%. 5,00,000 to 10%, 20%. More than 10,00,000, it is 30%. Sir, is it like flat rate or slab rate? How to apply this rate? Simple. Assume the total income of Vikas sir is 15,00,000. How to calculate the tax liability? Up to 2,50,000, nil, fine. Then from 2,50,000 to 5,00,000, it is 5%. That is, you should apply 5% on the difference amount. That is 2,50,000 into 5%. Fine, you will get 12,500. Then from 5,00,000 to 10,00,000, it is 20%. What is the difference amount? 5,00,000. Apply 5,00,000 into 20%. You would be getting 1,00,000. Then more than 10,00,000, the tax rate is 30%. What is the difference more than 10,00,000? 5,00,000. Because my total income is 15,00,000. So more than 10,00,000, how much is the difference? 5,00,000. So 5,00,000 into 30%, you should get it. Agree? So whatever amount you will get, add all the three. That is 12,500 plus 1,00,000 plus whatever you will get at the end. Clear? Chalo, sir. Then, sir, if I am a resident individual, age 60 or more, I would be called senior citizen. Agree? Only for resident individual, the basic exemption limit will be, instead of 2,50,000, it will be 3,00,000. Agree? Instead of 2,50,000, extra 50,000 benefit has been given. Sir, what if I am an individual who is aged 80 or more? I would be called as super senior citizen. Then for me, basic exemption limit would be 5,00,000. Not 2,50,000 or 3,00,000, it will be 5,00,000. So 5% slab is not at all applicable for me. It will straight away start with 20% slab. And this extension of basic exemption limit is applicable only for resident individual, not for anyone else. Clear? Okay. And CBDT has clarified that if an assessee is attaining the age of 60 or 80, even on 1st April of the assessment year, still you would be considered as attained the age on 31st March of the previous year of 60 years or 80 years. So if I am completing 60 years or 80 years on any day in the previous years, then I can claim a benefit of higher basic exemption limit. Fine, sir. Next category of assessees, firms, LLP and local authority, the tax rate would be 30% flat rate. That is, even if I have 10 rupees income, on that I have to apply 30% and I need to pay the tax to the government. This is called flat rate. Okay, so then good to know. See, for whoever we have seen two category of people, that is slab rate assessee and the three categories of flat rate assessee, for them a new special provision is applicable called alternate minimum tax, under which I will be calculating my tax liability at 18.5% on my adjusted total income. Sir, what is adjusted total income? How to compute it? Everything we would be seeing in chapter 12 of your syllabus, which I will take care later. Next, coming to companies, for income tax purpose, for applying the tax rates, we will divide companies into two categories: domestic company, foreign company. Foreign company, always the tax rate is 40%, whereas for domestic company, normally 30%. Normally 30%. If nothing is mentioned in the question, always apply 30%. If the turnover or gross receipts of the domestic company in the previous year 18-19 is up to 400 crore, then instead of 30%, the tax rate would be 25%. Instead of 30%, then the tax rate would be 25%. But for domestic company, there are some new schemes given under section 115 BA, BAA or BAB, where the tax rates are kept lower, like 15%, 22% or 25%. But if the question is silent, always apply 30% for domestic company, guys. Clear? Next, coming to cooperative society, again, slab rate is applicable for them. That is, if their income is up to 10,000, then the rate is 10%. From 10,000 to 20,000, 20%. More than 20,000, it is 30%. Again, this is slab rate, not flat rate. Come on, guys. So whatever we have seen now till now is the tax rate which is applicable for normal income. Sir, what is special income then? There are 4 or 5 special income. If my total income includes this special income, then I need to segregate my total income into two parts. First, I need to calculate tax on my special income at whatever rate they are given. That would be flat rate. For whomever is having the special income, for them, the same rates are applicable. It will not change depending upon the category of person. Agree? Whoever has a special income, they will pay tax at so and so rate, which is given in the respective section. Fine, sir. Then you will calculate tax on balance income at whatever rate applicable for you, either slab rate or flat rate, depending upon the category of person. Fine, sir. Then, sir, what are the special income and what is the tax rate applicable? Come on. First, we have to discuss capital gains. So under capital gains, there are two categories. That is long-term capital gain, short-term capital gain. If you are holding the asset for a long term, that long term might be 12 months, 24 months or 36 months, depending upon the type of the asset. If you are holding the asset for a long term before you sell it, it is whatever gain you will get it from that is called long term capital gain. Same way, if you are holding the capital asset for a short term, that is for less than 12 months, 24 months or 36 months, then whatever gain you will get from that asset is called short term capital gain. Agree? Fine. Come, first let us discuss short term capital gain. So if there is a short-term capital gain, you have to divide that into two parts. If there is a short-term capital gain on the three special assets, which are those three special assets? EFT, I will call it in short. What are those? Equity shares of a company, equity-oriented fund, or units of business trust. So if you are getting a short-term capital gain on the sale of these three things, and if you have paid securities transaction tax, then the tax rate applicable is 15% on the entire amount. Sir, what if there is a short-term capital gain on any other asset other than these three? If there is a short-term capital gain on any other asset, then normal rate is applicable for you. Sir, what is normal rate? Whatever we discussed in previous table. Agree? Fine. We are done with short-term capital gain. Coming to long-term capital gain. Again, we will divide that also into two categories. That is EFT and other assets. Sir, equity shares, equity-oriented fund or units of business trust. If there is any long-term capital gain, it is taxable at 10% in excess of 1 lakh. Up to 1 lakh, exemption is being given. Over and above 1 lakh, 10%. Over and above 1 lakh, 10%. Where it is given? 112A. Same thing if it is a short term, it is given under section 111A, 15%. Agree? So if there is any long term capital gain on transfer of any other asset other than EFT, sir, what might be there? Any other asset, land, building, machinery or any other asset. In that case, what will be the tax rate? 20% on full amount. 20% on full amount. Which section will tell this? 112. So we are done with capital gains. Then comes 115 BB. We call this as casual income. If there is any winnings from any lottery, crossword puzzle, gambling, betting, anything, then the tax rate is 30% flat for whomever is having this income. Agree? Then 115 BBE, if I have undisclosed income or investment, expenditure or anything for which I am not able to give any explanation, then in the year in whichever it is detected by the income tax authority, I need to pay tax at the rate of 60% plus 25% surcharge fixed plus 4% health and education cess. The rate actually comes to 78%. So these are the special incomes which are taxable at special rates. So whenever your total income includes this item, you have to be very careful. First calculate tax on special income, then only on the balance income you apply normal rate. Clear? Okay, sir. Next, coming to rebate. Rebate is one of the relief given to the resident individuals whose income is up to 5 lakh rupees, whose total income is up to 5 lakh rupees. If your income is 5 lakh 1 rupee also, you are not eligible for rebate. Agree? So what is the amount of rebate available? Your actual tax liability or 12,500, whichever is lower. Maximum rebate available for you, one of the MCQ question, 12,500. Rebate has to be claimed before health and education cess. And rebate is not available against the tax which you pay under section 112A, that is long-term capital gain on the transfer of EFT, just now whatever we discussed. Fine, so then comes surcharge. Sir, what is surcharge? Surcharge is an additional tax which is levied over and above income tax. What is income tax? Till now whatever rates we discussed, that is called income tax rates. So surcharge is applicable over and above the income tax rates. And it should be applicable on the rate amount of income tax, not on the amount of total income. Agree? And is surcharge applicable in all the situations? No. Only when your income is crossing so and so limits only surcharge is applicable. Chalo, first we will see what are the rates of surcharge for different category of people. So first comes our slab rate assessee, that is individual, HUF, UOP, BOIN, artificial juridical person. For them, when surcharge is applicable? Simple. Take total income. If total income including all the income, if it is crossing 50 lakh, then but less than 1 crore, up to 1 crore, then surcharge is 10%. If total income is more than 1 crore but up to 2 crore, it is 15%. More than 2 crore but up to 5 crore, it is 25%. But excluding three things, which are those? Long-term capital gain under section 112A, short-term capital gain under section 111A, that is EFT thing, both of them are related to EFT, then dividend income. You can observe all these three relating to securities actually. You have to exclude this. On this, whatever tax amount you have computed, on that maximum surcharge rate is applicable is 15%. Next, your total income excluding this three, if it is more than 5 crore, then surcharge applicable is 37%. But on this three special income, as per surcharge, the rate is 15%. Clear? If you are not covered in this two category, but if your income is more than 2 crore, then the surcharge rate applicable on your total income, including that three income, it is 15%. So what I can summarize using this is simple, guys. The maximum surcharge rate applicable on the three special income as per the surcharge concept is, that is 111A income, 112A income, and dividend income, the maximum surcharge rate is 15% on them. Agree? Chalo. Next, other assessees. If you are a firm, cooperative society, or local authority, if your total income, including everything, if it is more than 1 crore, then the surcharge rate is 12%. Next, if you are a domestic company, if your income is more than 1 crore but up to 10 crore, then 7%. If your total income is more than 10 crore, then 12%. If you are a foreign company, same situation, it is 2 and 5%. Instead of 7 and 12%, it is 2 and 5%. Sir, why it is less for foreign company? Because for foreign company, the tax rate itself is more, that is 40%. That is why we have kept surcharge rate at lower. Fine. Then, if the company has opted for that new scheme, BAA or BAB, the surcharge rate is always 10%, irrespective of their income. We will not check whether the income is crossing so and so limit. It is always 10%. Clear? If the company is opting for the two new schemes under section BAA or BAB. Fine, sir. Then coming to health and education cess. See, my tax calculation format is like this. First, I need to calculate income tax. Then for that, if surcharge is applicable, I will add it. On that amount, including that, I will calculate health and education cess. And health and education cess is always mandatory for everyone. Whoever is paying tax, it is mandatory at 4%. We have to calculate it at 4%. Chalo. Next, there is some special scheme or new scheme available for individuals and HUF as per Finance Act 2020, which is a new concept. So it is an option given to individual HUF. Here, the tax rates are lower for individual HUF, but if they want to opt for the scheme, they have to forego various exemptions and deductions. Agree? So this is an option given to individual HUF. If they want, they can choose, or else they can choose the old scheme. Agree? So what are the old rates applicable for individual HUF? It is given here. agree we discussed up to 2 lakh 50 nil, 2 lakh 50 to 5 lakh 5%, 5 lakh to 10 lakh 10-20%, more than 10 lakh 30%. Agree. Now under the new scheme, what are the rates? It is applicable for any individual, whether resident or non-resident, irrespective of age, and for every HUF. Only for two people this is applicable new scheme. This new scheme is given under section, which section? 115 BAC. What is the basic essential limit here? 2 lakh 50. From 2 lakh 50 to 5 lakh 5%, 5 lakh to 10, 7 lakh 50, 10%, 7 lakh 50,000 to 10 lakh, 15%, then 10 lakh to 12 lakh 50,000, 20%, 12 lakh 50 to 15 lakh, 25%, more than 15 lakh, 30%, more than 15 lakh, 30%. Clear? See, easy to remember. For every 2 lakh 50,000 increase in your total income, your tax rate will increase by 5%. Very easy to remember. Agree? Chalo. Sir, is surcharge applicable under the new scheme? Yes, at the same rate. That is 10, 15, 25, 37%, same rate, but including, excluding that 111A, 12A and all is not applicable under new scheme. You can take total income. If it is crossing 50 lakh, 1 crore, 2 crore, 5 crore, straight away apply whatever rate is available here. Agree? You need not include, exclude those three items. Fine, so. Then, if you are opting for this new scheme, you have to forego certain various deductions and exemptions under new scheme, which we will be learning in different chapters. Agree? Now, if you want to opt for this new scheme, then you have to assume you are divided into two categories now. If you are an individual HUF who has business income or professional income, then you have to choose this option before filing the return of income, before the due date of filing the return of income. But sir, if I am an individual or HUF who does not have business income or professional income, I can choose whether old scheme or new scheme when I am filing my return of income. When I am filing my return of income, and I have an option to switch every year from new scheme to old scheme, whichever I want. Whereas if I have business income or professional income, once I opt for new scheme, again I cannot come back for old scheme. But if I violate any of the provisions given under section 115 BAC, that is new scheme, then automatically I will be pushed from new scheme to old scheme. Again, I can never go back to new scheme. Agree? That is when I have business or professional income. Clear? Chalo. Then even under new scheme, the health and education says at 4% will be levied, and marginal relief will be available whenever surcharge is there. Then AMT provisions, that is alternate minimum tax provisions, are not available or not applicable for the assessee who opt for paying tax under the new scheme. Clear? Chalo. This is all about the new scheme. I have also given a comparison table, what is available, what is not available for new scheme and old scheme. You have to be remembering all this. See, for old scheme, the basic exemption limit depends on the age of the individual. Agree? Whereas under the new scheme, there is no age. For everyone, it is 2 lakh 50 only. Whether you are a 60 years, 80 years, 90 years, resident, non-resident, irrespective of everything, it is always 2 lakh 50. Then special rates are common for both new scheme as well as old scheme, whatever we have discussed under various sections. Then rebate is available for both the schemes. Then chapter 6A deductions, everything is available under old scheme, but under the new scheme, most of the things are not available. Only two deductions are available under chapter 6A. Then surcharges are applicable at the same rates under both the scheme. Health and education says same rate. Deductions and exemptions. See, under old scheme, I can claim almost all the exemptions and deductions, whereas under the new scheme, most of them are not available. Next, set off and carry forward of losses, depreciation from past previous year. Normally, I can set off my loss or carry forward my loss under the old scheme, whereas under the new scheme, if it is related to the deductions or exemptions which are not available under the new scheme, I cannot carry forward it. Good. Next, if I am having any current year loss, I can adjust it against any other income under the new scheme, old scheme, whereas under the new scheme, if it is a house property loss, I cannot adjust it against any other income. Clear? Then AMT provisions is applicable under old scheme, but not applicable under the new scheme. If I am opting for a new scheme, then it is my duty to inform that I am opting for a new scheme. Whereas if I am opting for an old scheme, I need not inform anything. It is implied that I am following the old scheme. Clear? Then I have to round off my total income to the nearest 10 rupees as per section 288A. And I have to round off my tax liability to the nearest 10 rupees as per section 288B. Agree? you have to be very careful while calculating the tax liability. So this is the format of calculating the tax liability. Whenever you have total income, if it includes any special income, please break your total income into two parts. First, calculate tax liability on your special income. Then calculate tax on your balance income by applying the normal rates. Fine, sir. Check whether rebate is applicable. If yes, claim the rebate. If not, next go to the step surcharge. Surcharge is not applicable in all the situation. It is applicable only when your total income is crossing so and so limits. So apply surcharge. Whenever you apply surcharge, please be careful with one concept called marginal relief. Then after that, whatever surcharge should be calculated on your tax liability, not on your income. Then after adding surcharge for your tax liability, whatever figure you will get on that, always add 4% health and education cess. Agree? That will be your tax liability. This will be your tax liability. From that, if you have any interest liability for delay payment of filing of income tax returns and all, add it. Then if you have already paid tax to the government in the form of tax deducted at source or TDS, advanced tax, self-assessment tax and all, reduce it. And final tax, if anything is there, you clear it to the government. Or else, if you have already paid excess amount, claim a refund of it. Clear? Then, sir, if I have agriculture income, normally it is exempt under the Income Tax Act. But if I have both agriculture income as well as non-agriculture income, the computation of tax liability is different. How is that? The format has been given under the Act. So how is that? First, you had both agriculture income as well as non-agriculture income. Calculate tax on that. Sir, what rate is applicable? Whatever rate is applicable for you, depending upon the category of assessee. Then that step is done. Calculate tax on that. Then agriculture income plus basic essential limit you take. Calculate tax on that. Calculate tax on that. Fine. At whatever rate is applicable for you. Second step is done. Tax payable would be D minus F. That is tax on your total. That is agri plus non-agri minus tax on your agriculture income plus basic essential limit. You do deduct one another, you will be getting net tax payable. That means indirectly they are showing it here, you are not paying tax on your agriculture income. Fine, sir. From that, if you are eligible for a rebate, that is when your non-agriculture income is up to 5 lakh, claim rebate. If not, add surcharge if it is applicable. When surcharge would be applicable? Only when your non-agriculture income is crossing the so-and-so limit. Fine, sir. Then add health and education cess in all the scenario at 4%. So whatever final figure you will be getting, you will be paying that to the government. This is not applicable in all the situation. It is applicable only for individual HUF, EOP and BOI who have net agriculture income more than 5,000 and non-agriculture income more than basic exemption limit. Only in that situation, you have to apply this concept, or else always calculate the tax liability as we have done in normal situations. Agree? Always, whenever before applying this concept, first check clearly whether this concept is applicable or not. Agree? Where it is given in the note. First check whether note is applicable, then only apply the concept. Then we have one last concept called marginal relief. Sir, what is marginal relief? It is a relief given to the payer of surcharge. Surcharge is an additional tax which we are charging. Agree? When surcharge is applicable? When my total income is crossing so and so limits. Agree? My total income is crossing so and so limit, but by a little margin, by a little amount. In that case, I am paying surcharge at 10%, 15%, 25%. Agree? Assume my total income is only 50 lakh, 10,000, 51 lakh. So it is crossing only by a small margin, but you are charging on your total tax liability 10% surcharge. In that situations, I can claim a marginal relief. Agree? Marginal relief will be available only when it is a positive figure. If it is a negative figure, it will always be zero. Clear? Chalo. How to calculate marginal relief? First, take your total income. There are three steps total here. 1, 2, 3. Agree? So first, calculate the tax liability as usual. Total income, take total income, calculate tax on that. And surcharge also you have to add. But don't add health and education cess. Agree? So you will get tax liability as per step 1. Then second step is important. Tax on the limit whatever you are crossing. You are crossing some limit. That is why surcharge is applicable. Sir, what is that limit? It might be 50 lakh, 1 crore, 2 crore, 5 crore or 10 crore. Agree? Chalo. Calculate tax on that figure. And see whether you are crossing second, third or fourth limit. In that case, you have to add surcharge also in second step. Fine, sir. Then for whatever tax amount you have got, add the total income minus whatever limit you have taken previously. Agree? Total income minus the limit whatever you have crossed. Whatever figure you will get, add it. Agree? So you will get one more tax figure here. Lower of these two you will be your tax liability, for which you have to add 4% health and education cess. So this is your A and this is your B. If A minus B is your positive figure, then you are eligible to claim marginal relief. If not, you are not eligible for marginal relief. Clear? This is all about your tax rates chapter.